So let's start. So the agenda for our time journey today, we're going to see the APIs that already supported for backup in oVirt. Then we'll present to you, we'll do a little jump to the future and see the incremental backup API. Then we will dive under the DeLorean hood and see how it works. Then we'll see how we can use it using the engine and image.io backup API. So how many of you used oVirt or using it today? Can you please raise your hands? Nice, thank you. I see quite a few people. Thank you. So this is oVirt from 10,000 meters above. oVirt contains a lot of sub-products and a lot of components, but this is the main component that's related to backup. We have the oVirt engine application, the management. We have the hypervisors that runs the VMs, and we have the VMs disks. Also, we have an external backup application that wants to backup the VM disks and communicate with the engine itself. So let's review the old APIs, the old backup APIs. Let's take jump back to the past. So the oldest API that oVirt provides is the backup appliance. The year is 2014, even before I was born. The backup appliance run inside the VM, and let's see how it can be done. You should take a snapshot for a VM. Then you need to attach this disk snapshot to a backup VM, to a proxy VM basically, which is different from the original VM you want to backup. Then inside this backup VM, you will copy the entire disk, detach the disk snapshot from the backup VM, and delete the snapshot. We move forward a little bit in time, the image transfer API. So the year is 2017. Now you can download and upload snapshots using the image.io that was presented in the oVirt 4.0. And you do this by taking your snapshot for the VM, downloading the snapshot using image.io in Qcode2 format, and delete the older snapshot. To restore, you will prepare the disk on the backup application, rebase the snapshots. For example, upload the disk or the chain of snapshot in RAW or Qcode format, and then you will create a VM from the uploaded disk.
So the new incremental backup API. Fasten your seatbelt, we're going to jump to the future. The year is next year, it's not ready yet, we're working on it. Now we do incremental backup using change block tracking and NBD protocol. It will be available in oVirt 4.4 as a tech preview using upstream Libvirt and Qemu. And in the next version, I hope that we will have backup application using it. So how do we do full backup using this API? We start a backup. We provide a simple API to start a backup. And then we download the disk using the same APIs that we had before, but with some improvements. For example, now we can download all the raw guest data, regardless of the disk format. And we stop the backup. And there is no step four. So we provide very simple API, and we do the heavy lifting. Actually, Libvirt is doing the heavy lifting and Qemu. How do we do incremental backup? In the same way, we start incremental backup using the same API. We specify the last backup that we want to backup, we want to see the changes since that backup. And then we can download the change blocks since that backup. Again, using raw format. We don't care about the actual format of the disk. And we stop the backup. So this is basically from the user point of view, it's very simple. And when you go to restore, the backup application will have to prepare the disk for restore. It can be an image, it can be done by streaming from the backup media. And again, we can push the raw guest data back to storage. We don't care about the disk format. And finally, we attach a disk to a new VM. So what are the advantages of the new way? First, we can copy change blocks instead of all the disk. This speeds up incremental backup, or actually enable it. Next, we have extents API, reporting where do we have zeros and dirty extents on storage. So this can speed up full backup. We don't need to copy the entire disk, only the data. Next, there's no snapshot. We don't need to create snapshot. We don't need to delete snapshot. Snapshots are very complicated, and this avoids the trouble with snapshots. The next advantage is raw guest data. We always get raw data. We don't care about this format. And when you got raw data, you can convert it to another format. It's easy. It's not easy to get Qemu2 format and convert it because Qemu2 was not built for streaming. And finally, we have improved the Miagio client that can upload and download any format for you from any image to any disk or from any disk to any image. The limitation of this solution, we support only Qemu2 disks. So if you have raw disks, we can do full backup, but it cannot participate in incremental backup. You will have to convert it. We cannot backup non-running VM yet. We should be able to do it in the future. And the extents API reporting the zero extents or dirty extents is not useful for a pre-located disk. We just get one extent. We cannot do anything about it.
Okay, so we have incremental backup. Let's see how it's done under the DeLorean hood. So in the base of all that, we have checkpoints. Checkpoints are, we can imagine it as lightweight snapshots. When we are creating a backup, a checkpoint is created in Libvirt. Each checkpoint actually marks us which disks participate in a specific backup. And the checkpoint, of course, marks which backup is related to. So in this example, you can see that the user created a backup and a checkpoint was created in Libvirt side. Moving forward, the day after, the user created another backup, so another checkpoint is created, but now that checkpoint has a parent, the first checkpoint, so we're creating a chain of snapshot of checkpoints. The same disk participates in the checkpoint also. Again, the user creates the third checkpoint, and now we have a full chain of checkpoints, and the checkpoints persisted on the host as long as the VM is alive. If the VM shut down or crashes, the checkpoint information is gone. So the oVirt engine will persist all that information in this database. And when the VM goes up again, we need to redefine the checkpoints so Libvirt will know which checkpoint it was. But checkpoints only give us metadata about the backup, what really tracked diff between the bits. So this is done by dirty bitmaps, dirty bitmaps created in Qemu. So when we are creating a backup, a checkpoint is created, and for each checkpoint, we are creating a bitmap. Okay, in this example, you can see that the user created a checkpoint for SDA, the disk SDA, and the disk no writes is done to the disk is clean, since the backup was taken, so the bitmap of the checkpoint is still clean. Each bit in the bitmap will mark us each cluster in the disk got dirty. For example, we move onward in time, and you can see that the second cluster got dirty, so the bit that marks us if the second cluster is dirty or not was turned on. Moving on, the guest writes another data to the fourth and the fifth cluster. We can see that even that the fourth cluster not changed fully, we are still mark it as dirty. Now the user finished the first backup and created another backup. So the first checkpoint, the first bitmap of that checkpoint is now deactivated, and the state is preserved. And since we created the second backup, we can see that there's no changes, and the bitmap is still clean. So now that we have the bitmaps, we can know which extent exactly got dirty during that backup, and when the user will start to backup his the VM for that checkpoint, he will get only the dirty extents. For example, the first cluster is still clean, no changes was made, and the second cluster got dirty, so the dirty will be true for the second cluster. Okay, so we know it works under the hood. Let's see how we can use it using oVirt Python SDK. So in order to start a full backup, you just need to fetch the backup services of a specific VM, okay? And just use the add method and providing disks to the backup, okay? The disk that you provided will be participated in the backup. In this example, this is a full backup. And this is the first stage. We will wait until the backup is ready for the backup status, and then we'll get the backup object. So as we mentioned before, when we're creating a backup, a checkpoint is created under the hood. So we need to fetch the checkpoint ID in order to use it later in an incremental backup. So now we have the checkpoint ID, we have the backup ready, we can start an image transfer. This is an image IO. So we will provide the disk ID that we want to download, the direction, and because this is a disk that participates in a backup, we need to specify the backup ID, and the disk format will be raw. We're supporting raw guest data. We wait for the transfer to be ready, and we fetch the transfer URL once the transfer is ready for download. Using that transfer URL, we can actually download the disk, and we will elaborate it more later on. So we download the disk, we have the disk ready, we can finalize the transfer and finalize the backup. We have a full backup on our environment. So now we can start an incremental backup. So it's basically the same, but for incremental backup, the user must specify each disk will support the incremental backup, and those disks must be in QCO2 format. So we'll filter the disks, and we'll fetch only the disk that supports incremental backup. Once we have the disk, we can start an incremental backup and specify the from checkpoint ID. So we create the chain of checkpoints, and the diff will be preserved from that checkpoint on.
So how will we download the backups? Basically, we can do a simple GET request and get the entire disk. It works, but it's not efficient. We don't want to use this. So the real way to do backup is first to send an option request to the server, and this will tell us the features supported by this server, or actually for this source on this server. So here we see that this server and for this image, we can use the extents feature, and we can use zero and flush used for upload. And we can also see that we can optimize the connection using Unix socket if you are running on the same machine, and we can use multiple connections to speed up the transfer. Also a new feature. So we want to get to backup 100 gigabytes image. How many gigabytes do we need? Well, we don't know. But we don't know that we care only about the data. We don't care about the zeros. So we can use the new extents API. We send a GET request to the extents or source of the transfer URL, and we can specify zero to get the zero extents. And we get a list, a JSON request with a list of extents, similar to what we get in Qemu image map, basically. We can see that the first extent is zero, so we can skip it, we don't care about it. And the second extent is not zero, so we want to download it. And now we saved a huge amount of data and time and storage space when doing full backup. And what about incremental backup? In the same way, we want to know where are the dirty blocks. We have seen that before. We can, again, use the extents API, but now we specify context dirty to get the dirty extents, and again, we get a list of extents, and we can see that the first extent is dirty, so we want to download it. It's one cluster, and then we have a lot of clean data that we don't care about, and we can skip it. So we again, we save a lot of time and bandwidth and storage space. So how do we get the extents? We know the locations, you know the offsets. We use HTTP range request, standard HTTP. Just send a GET request with a range header, and we get this data. And we need, of course, to make one request per extent. So how do we speed up the upload in the same way when you want to restore disks? Again, we care only about the data. So we can send the data using put request. This is not new. It exists a lot of time since oVirt 4.0 or even before. We specify the content range for the offset and the size with the content length. And again, we need to send one request per data extent. And what about the zeros? Can we ignore the zeros? Well, sometimes we can ignore them. When we create a new image on file storage, the image is always empty. We don't need to zero anything. But on block storage, the contents is undefined usually. So we want to zero the this range of storage, but we don't want to send zeros on the wire, which is not efficient. So we have zero API implemented using patch. We send a patch request with a JSON describing how do you want to patch the image, which is kind of standard. And we can specify zero operation, offset and size, and it will zero this range on the storage efficiently using NBD or using our file backend. And of course, when we finish the upload, we sent all the data, we zeroed everything we need to zero. Are we done yet? Well, maybe. We really want to send a flush request, which can also be sent during the upload if we need. And this will basically call fsync under the hood. And when this returns, the data should be safe on storage. So it is too complicated, maybe. So we have a better solution, but this is actually what the cool kids are using now. In this example, these kids bought a hoverboard kit, and they only had to add wheels to it to work. So in the same way, the image IO client library let you build your own backup solution, you just need to add the wheels, which may be complicated. So what you can do with a client, you can build a backup solution on it. You can use it as a reference implementation to learn how to access image IO in the correct way, in the efficient way. And you can do simple backups using, we have an example backup script that you can use to backup single image or store images as a testing or simple solution. How does it work? You basically interact with the client and it does everything for you. It will run Qemu NBD, opening the image you want to upload or the image you want to download into. Then using NBD client, we will get the extents from the image, send them to the image daemon, which on the other side also use Qemu NBD. So basically it's Qemu NBD all the way down. And for download, on the other side we can have Qemu and we will use NBD protocol to get the extents, to get the data and write it to the destination file. Again, using Qemu NBD and NBD client. And this is an example how to use it for download. One call, you import the client, do one call with the transfer URL you get from the image transfer from engine and the name of the file. The default is QCAP2 format because it's the best way to backup data and it's compatible with both full and incremental backups, but you can change it. For incremental backup, you only need to specify incremental equal to, and this will go and get the dirty extents for you and download them. And in this case, only QCAP2 format is supported. And for a store, if you use this simple way to backup, you can take your incremental backup images, rebase them on one on top of another until the full backup. And after the rebase, you have a complete chain. You can just upload this chain. Basically, mostly like Qemu image convert, but using Qemu NBD underneath. So this will upload the entire chain, actually get the data extents, upload them, and zero whatever is not data. So time for a demo.
Okay, so now we'll show you a quick demo that uses this client solution, the new image IO client, and the Python SDK. So in this example, we have a VM, a Fedora 30 VM, and it has a disk. We just mark it as an enable incremental backup, and we can start to perform a full backup in this case. We just open a console to create a directory to illustrate that this directory will be part of the backup, and we'll create another one later to see that the other directory that was created after the backup was started is not participated in the backup. So we start the script that we provided you using the Python SDK and the new Image.io client. The backup was started for the VM. We are creating another backup after the backup was started, another directory after the backup was started, the after directory. We can see that the backup already ready, so we are waiting for the image transfer. We created it, and it's ready. So we can fetch after that the transfer URL. From this URL, we can download the disks. It will be downloaded to the following path. And as soon as the disk was downloaded, 6 GB of disk, we have the backup. As I mentioned before, this is a full backup. We can see it, and we create another QCO layer on top of it, and we can start QEMO on that QCO layer. So we have a Fedora 30 VM, and we have only the before directory and not the after. Okay, for more information, you have links here to dive into this new feature, and also Libvirt and QEMO implementation. Thank you for listening. Any questions? Yes. We are providing, the question was that if we need, we are need to orchestrate the backups, or the sysadmin will have to do it. So oVirt provide the API. The sysadmin can do whatever he wants with that API. He can orchestrate the backup each day, hour, month, up to him.
Yes, but basically we provide an API. The backup vendor should provide the real system behind it. Backup, it's more complicated.
More questions?
And what is actual status of this project of incremental backups? Where is fully working, or is...
Well, what you will see in the demo is working now in master. So it should be available in the next oVirt 4.4 build. We are working on the enabling incremental backup and managing checkpoints. And this should be completed in for an, a future for build, and should be used for vendors to develop applications for backup, and probably will be finished in the next rev version.
Yes.
The fact that the backup is done using Libvirt, and when the VM is running, it does not Libvirt. So we need to introduce a new special mode of running a VM, a new backup mode, when you start a VM paused, and then we can use the old, all the APIs to do anything we need. And we don't have it yet.
More questions? Okay, great. I guess that's it. Thank you very much.